The topic of this lesson is one more interpolation method, which is called kriging. Like many of the other interpolation methods we saw in the previous lesson, it is a weighted average method. But it is a little more sophisticated in how it tries to account for the spatial correlation in a dataset. For instance, if we look at inverse distance weighting, we can define a power parameter that tells us how quickly the weight of a nearby sample point decreases as we move farther from it. But the method doesn't give us a way to objectively define this parameter based on the characteristics of our dataset. It also assumes that the correlation between two points is equal to the inverse of their distance to a power, which can be a decent approximation but is not always true. Kriging is different because it actually creates a model of spatial correlation that tells us the proper weights we can use depending on the distance between the interpolated point and all of the other sample points. This model can be customized depending on many factors, and different types of kriging can be used to create different types of models. In this lesson, we look at two types of kriging, simple kriging and ordinary kriging. In order to understand their differences, let's start by considering the equation that's typically used to describe geostatistical models. Geostatistics considers that a random variable z, which represents a spatially correlated property at a given location, can be decomposed into two related variables. The first of these is a non-random spatial trend that can be modeled by the expectation, using something like a constant, a polynomial, or a spline. And the second is a random but spatially correlated deviation from this trend. In simple kriging, we assume that the expectation is the same everywhere and that it is known. We also assume that the covariance between a random variable at two locations doesn't depend on the locations themselves, but instead can be defined based only on the vector separating them. Like other interpolation methods, simple kriging uses a weighted average. But since we're assuming that the expectation is the same everywhere, we will define this weighted average and the residuals, the second term of the previous equation. So, if we look at the system of equations for simple kriging, we can put all the correct values in the equation. Here, x0 is the interpolated point, x1 to xn are the sample points within its search radius, and w1 to wn are the weights that we give to the value of points x1 to xn. C is the covariance, which is obtained based on the distance between the two points. Now, we reach the problematic aspects of simple kriging. First, we don't know what covariance functions to use. This is not ideal, but we can use something based on any of the theoretical variogram functions that we discussed in the next section of the video. The second problem is that we also don't know what is the expectation here. Also not ideal, but maybe we can make a big assumption and use something like the arithmetic mean of all the points. That being said, the better option is to avoid simple kriging entirely and instead use ordinary kriging with a variogram. The variogram expresses the difference in the value of a random variable between sample points at different distances. So, in this function, we start with a sample point x, and we consider the value of the random variable z at this location, which in the context of our course could be the elevation at the point x. Then, we consider a point x plus h, where h is a vector between x and a different sample point. Z of x plus h is the elevation at this sample point. So, the right side of the equation expresses the difference between the elevations of two points which are separated by h. The square comes from the definition of the variance, which you can see in the handout. We see h again in the left side of the equation, and the gamma of h is the variogram function. If we do this calculation using every possible pair of sample points in a dataset, or maybe with a subset if that is too slow, we end up with something like this, which is called a variogram cloud. In this plot, the x-axis is the distance between a pair of sample points, and the y-axis is the variogram function. Here, we can already see some typical characteristics of a variogram cloud. Since nearby sample points tend to have similar values, the dissimilarity tends to increase as the distance between sample points increases. However, the pattern in the variogram cloud is still not very clear, so the next step is to create bins that define distance intervals, and then we compute the average dissimilarity in each bin. We normally do this up to about half the size of the region covered by the dataset. The end result looks something like this and is called the experimental variogram. In it, we can already see a clearer pattern for how the average dissimilarity between points increases as the distance between them also grows. So, the next step is to fit the pattern in the experimental variogram with a theoretical variogram function. In the handout, we look at three of these: exponential, Gaussian, and spherical, but there are actually many more. There are ways to do this automatically, but for the purposes of this course, we will assume that this will be done manually by looking at different functions and defining the value of some parameters. The typical parameters are three, and they are called the seal, the nugget, and the range. The seal is the value of the maximum dissimilarity between points. The nugget is the value of the dissimilarity of points at the same location, so when it is not zero, the data is usually noisy or the resolution of the dataset is low. Finally, the range is the value of the minimum distance before you reach the seal, after which the dissimilarity tends to flatten out. So, now we can use the fitted theoretical variogram function to perform ordinary kriging. Like in other spatial interpolation methods, if we want to interpolate the value at a given point, which is here marked as x0, we typically use a search radius around it. Another common option to limit the search is to get a given number of its nearest neighbors, such as 10. In this radius we will find some other points, which are marked here as x1 to x5. And we will use the distance between the interpolated point and each of the other sample points to determine the proper weights to use by inputting this distance in the theoretical variogram function. So, if we look at the system of equations for ordinary kriging, we can put all the correct values. Here, x0 is the interpolated point, x1 to xn are the sample points within its search radius, and w1 to wn are the weights that we give to the value of points x1 to xn. Gamma of a vector means evaluating the distance between the two points in the theoretical variogram function. If we look at the three big matrices here, A, W, and D, the weight matrix is the unknown one that we need to calculate. So, we solve for W by passing the A matrix to the right side and inverting it. Finally, there are some computational aspects that you need to take into account if you use kriging. Matrices W and D here are just vectors, but matrix A is square, and it can be very big if you use a large search radius. Since inverting a matrix is computationally expensive and this has to be done once for every interpolated point, kriging can be much slower than other interpolation methods. So, try to use a relatively small search radius, but this radius should still always contain other sample points.